Welcome to Indian Aesthetics, and this topic has a lot of new names and concepts. Let's try to make it as lucid as I possibly can. So we are all familiar with this beautiful poetry by John Keats, "A thing of beauty is a joy forever." And beauty is something which attracts every one of us. Like yesterday we studied about primordial images and archetypes. Every culture has some kind of fascination towards beauty. And beauty, that exactly is what is studied in aesthetics. So now Indian aesthetics would be more inclined towards the Indian or the Hindu perspective from the philosophical or spiritual viewpoint on Indian art, architecture, literature, poetry, music, dance forms, and all of that. Why do we study aesthetics? Because we want to familiarize ourselves with all of our literary artwork right down from our Sanskrit texts. Another reason could be we want to, you know, dilute the effects of colonialism on us. So appreciate the beauty that we have in our culture. So these are certain reasons why, you know, aesthetics is important for us to study and explore. The Indian aesthetics is much older than Western aesthetics, as we'll discover when we read about Bharat Muni. We'll see the timeline when Bharat Muni's Natyashastra treatise is presented as compared to the Western philosophers. The political arena of Indian aesthetics was very different from what we have today. So Mauryan Empire, Gupta Empire, they all influenced Indian aesthetics. One important thing to note down here is India has been home to a wide range of cultures. Lots of foreign influences have come up. We retained our own sanctity and yet we embraced a lot of beautiful elements from different cultures, be that the Islamic culture or Christianity, Portuguese, British influences. We took it all and we can see those influences in our literature, our architecture, our temples, our domes, and all of those structures. A new term that I would like to introduce you here is Ras Utpan. The word Utpan means evocation or creation. So aesthetics, you know, when if you just imagine, if you look at a rose, what does it do to you? You love the fragrance of the rose. It evokes certain feelings inside you. This is exactly what happens when we read a beautiful piece of literature. For instance, if you read Adi Shankaracharya's work, the kind of poetic beauty, the chand that is over there, the alliterations used, they're all so beautiful and they evoke certain feelings within us. So Indian aesthetics, we will have a few domains here, as in the religious foundations, mystic functions, influence of Krishna, and whether it has non-spiritual connotations as well. The religious foundations just tell us that our Indian art, as well as criticism, has a very theistic base. So wherever our literature is coming from, be it Kamayani, be it Kalidasa's literature, there would be influences by Hindu faith or philosophy. And later on, you know, the Sufi cultures or the Sher and the Urdu poetry, all of these have greatly influenced Indian aesthetics. You look at paintings. When we go to monasteries, we see the Buddhist culture has influenced the paintings, the usage of colors, the choice of motifs out there. So all of these religion-based cultures have strongly influenced the Indian aesthetics, and the most of it has been dominated by Lord Krishna and his Ras Leela and the gopis, and that has had a very strong influence on Indian aesthetics. So aesthetics is not just about the spiritual dimension, but a lot of sensuous dimension also, as Kalidasa's literature or also Geet Govindam. So there would be description of beauty, feminine beauty, and things like that. And all of these, you know, naturalistic, sensory or humanistic expressions, they've all made a strong mark on our philosophical traditions. Now, beside the religious influences, our art has been strongly influenced by mystic functions or the more spiritual inclination, as in our prime theme would be achieving moksha or liberation, you know, or cutting down the cycle of birth and rebirth and death and all of that. So as you can see in this image, the Lord Shiva, dancing Shiva, this figure is known as Nataraj. And this symbolizes the cosmic rhythm of creation and destruction. And we find lots of such motifs all around us. Whenever we explore Indian art form, whether that's literature, whether that's poetry, whether that's sculpture or anything. And finally, the greatest of it all, the greatest of influencers of Indian aesthetics and Indian ras, you can say, would be Lord Krishna, whether that was a small child, Bal Gopal, or the adolescent Krishna with all of that Ras Leela, and the Krishna teaching Arjuna strong messages of Bhagavad Gita, that has very strongly influenced the Hindu worldview of karma. You know, you just go on doing about your deeds and don't bother about the fruit. So now coming to the prime topic, ras. The word ras means juice, and Rigveda, Samveda, Upanishads, all of them have had their own descriptions of ras. But what ras essentially means, it's a mental state. It's a very dominant emotional theme, and it is evoked whenever you read something or you hear something or you witness a beautiful work of art. I'd like to give you a very small demonstration or example out of this. It's raining in most of our cities. I think, Reti ma'am, you're in Mumbai, it might be raining out there. I'm in Kolkata, it's raining here. I don't know what about Delhi. So the season of monsoon here in India has a particular raga in classical music associated with it, and that's known as Rag Malhar. Okay? And if you listen to Rag Malhar, you'll really feel that rain showers are all around you. Okay? So, I mean, it's like there are lots of bandishes around it. For instance, you know, Bijuri chamke barse meharwa aayi badariya. All, you know, those kind of words and the usage of notes will also evoke that feeling within you. This is very important. Even if you don't understand it, please mug this up. This might be a very important term when you attempt a question on Indian aesthetics, and that is Sthayi Bhav. Sthayi or Sthir means something that is permanent, and from the Sthayi Bhav, the ras is evoked or developed whenever you come in contact with a form of art. And Sthayi Bhav results from the interplay of these three emotional conditions. Please learn these by heart. I'm not going to dwell a lot in these because there's a lot to cover. So these are Vibhavas, Anubhavas and Sanchari. And these are described over here. And if you'll have any doubt here, please message me separately and I'll try to explain the best that I can. Okay? So Vibhav is divided into Alamban Vibhav and Uddipina Vibhav. And I could be goofing up with the pronunciation here. Anyway, now let's move on to the most important superstar of Indian aesthetics, Bharat Muni. And he was the first person, I mean one of the first persons, and he attributes Lord Shiva. He says that, you know, Lord Shiva created the Nad and the Om and sound, and he taught to Narad, and Narad spread it all across to other, like that's how Hindu mythology goes on. So Bharat Muni, for the first time in his treatise of Natya Shastra, talked about various ras. Okay, the orange, the words that are in orange, I'm going to come up here in this page also. So these are eight forms of ras that he had described, and the ninth one, Shant Ras, was added later. So I'll just quickly name all these rasas and just quickly try to explain if there is anything worth. So Shringaras is all about, you know, love and you know, cajoling your beloved and decorating yourself. So there are lots of songs based on that, you know, Lat Uljhi Suljhaja Balam, that's a bandish in Rag Maru Bihag. Hasya Ras Ik Chatur Nar Karke Singar, that song would be there. Rudra, you know, Shaurya and you're angry, that kind of a Shaurya is Veer, I'm sorry. Rudra is anger. Karunya means compassion. Vibhats, disgust, you know, like something dirty or something very intolerable, that kind of a feeling. Bhayanak, terrible, horror. And Adbhut, amazement, awe, admiration. And Shant Ras is also primarily Bhakti Ras, you know, Tora Man Darpan Kehlawe, Tu Pyar Ka Sagar Hai, those songs, or lots of bhajans are, you know, around the this particular Ras. So, more important thing to note here is 8 were given by Bharat Muni and the 9th one, Shant Ras, was added later. Okay? Now, after Bharat Muni, what happened? I mean, there were certain problems arising out of his explanation of Ras, and lots of other philosophers, sages, you know, lots of Indian literature had been contributed by meditators, sages, okay, philosophers, which is why we don't just tell them authors. They're not simply authors. They were a lot more than that. So these are some names. Please, please do learn these names. So Bhatt Lolat, Bhatt Nayaka, Abhinav Gupta, Bhama, Rudrata, Dandin, Anand Vardhan. These are all important names that we'll have to learn. And when you read this, you might be able to familiarize yourself more with all of these terms. So Abhinav Gupta, important here is he wrote the Abhinav Bharti. And he had also elaborated the theory of Dhwani, Dhwani, that is sound. And he picked up lots of important shlokas from these Mahakavya books, like that from Kalidas and other authors. And he proved that poetry should evoke Ras. You know, that is the most important objective of a poetry. Then Bhatt thought, stated, you know, he wrote a book called Kavya Kautuk. And he said, you know, that when you witness a play, you actually do not remember the names that they are playing. Like, for instance, if I'm in a play and I play the role of, say, Sita or Draupadi or any particular character, you won't think that I'm Richa. You know, you would really associate me with the character that I'm playing. So these are the kind of transcendental experiences that are enjoyed by us, you know, as an audience when we witness a form of art. And a lot of them have talked about theater, actually, because theater in those times was the greatest form of art that could integrate literature as well as poetry, as well as music and dance and all of that, and art and painting. So like today, a movie or a documentary could be the highest form of art because it integrates all these other forms of art. Then Bhatt Lolat, he also states that, you know, we might experience a particular Ras in a secondary form when we are playing that character. For instance, in Ram Leela, the actors who are playing that role, you know, they are not the first ones who experience the exact love which Ram and Sita had for each other. But they imagine the kind of love and affection and the zone that Ram and Sita were in, and they attribute these roles to themselves, and they experience this particular Ras secondarily. I'm sure you must have experienced this when you watch something on the TV screen, or if you watch theater and you watch those characters and you really feel those emotions emanating from those characters. So this is the beauty of aesthetic. So Bhatt Lolat dwells a lot on these areas. Then some other names, you know, Mamat and Shankuka, they also had their own theory. So Mamat was a follower of Abhinav Gupta. He re-established the theory of Dhwani, and he stated that, you know, even if the agency that created that particular act is destroyed, the action may still remain intact. Okay, so for instance, even after you saw a Ramayana or a Mahabharata or an act like that, the influence or the effect or the bhav or the ras might be there in your heart even after you've witnessed that. Shankuka stated that now, even if you look at an object which is not exactly that living object, but it represents that object, and yet you can attach or associate the qualities of the original object to this particular object. So here, for example, this is a horse. All of us can say that it's a horse, but it's not a real horse. It's not a breathing horse. We cannot ride this horse. It cannot take us to places. Yet, we accept that this is a horse. This is what happens when a spectator, when an audience watches emotions that are, you know, acted by the actor on the screen, on the stage. Okay. Next is Bhatt Naika, and his view was slightly different. He stated that through Ras, the spectator, you know, the person who is watching that art form or reading that art form, becomes one with the divine soul. So, for example, if I give my own example, if I'm reading Adi Shankaracharya's Bhaj Govindam, for instance, I might really feel those, devotional feelings. And you might be teary-eyed, you might be overwhelmed or drenched with those divine emotions. So he says that the objective of a poet or a creator should be to give this kind of experience to the author or the audience, as well as himself also experience that. So he uses terms like, you know, flash of bliss, swarupananda, you know, the infinity, self-realization, atma sakshatkar means coming in connection, coming in contact with one's own soul, and those kind of terms. And the individual soul becomes a part of the supreme soul. Now let's move on to some technical terms that are used in Indian aesthetics. Dhvani. Dhvani, as the name suggests, means sound or symbol. Here we can understand this using one very beautiful example. For example, you use a term oh. So Anand Vardhan stated that the way you use the last symbol, that will actually tell you the kind of meaning that you should associate from that particular word. So if somebody tells, if I tell you, I had a very bad day and I was not able to study all day, I had so much a problem, and then I might say, oh, I'm so tired, I didn't want to give this presentation, and look at the oh that I use. So the H sound finally, it shows how tired or how lethargic or how, you know, negative I am. And if I tell you, my next song is coming up, oh, I'm so excited, just for instance, it's just a hypothetical example. So that oh, the word is same, but the expression, the kind of sound that I used to articulate that word is different, and that completely changes the meaning of that word. This is what is the importance of dhvani. And this kind of suggestion or this kind of symbolism is very important in poetry. Dhvani are of three types: Vastu dhvani, Alankar dhvani, Ras dhvani. We're not dwelling in detail with these phrases. So Ras dhvani is when you listen to something and that gives you a feeling of joy or sadness. So when you listen to Rag Hansa dhvani, for example, I'm talking words that are really weird. Rag Hansa dhvani is a Carnatic raga, and it's the usage of notes are very happy notes. So listening to that might make you feel very happy, and listening to a very sad song might make you feel very sad. So this is the power of dhvani. Now the criticism of dhvani theory is, see, this is actually a product of inference. So what you feel might be very different from what I feel, and this could be really very subjective. Dhvani is non-existent. It's not tangible. So you cannot really see where dhvani is. You can just hear it, or maybe you can just perceive or feel it. And it's beyond the realm of words. It's just how we articulate or speak or hear something that we can make an inference about the meaning of that word or that poetry or that phrase. Now, this is another new term over here, Alankar. Alankar is actually nothing but, as English students, we've studied Alankar a lot. We've studied about figures of speech. That is exactly what alankar is. So alankar, the word in Hindi and Sanskrit, means ornamentations, embellishments, decorations of poetry, literary embellishments. For instance, she sells seashells on the seashore, and that is alliteration, the letter S being used repetitively. So figures of ghan ghamand ghan garjat ghora priya heen darpat man mora. This is a verse from Ramcharitmanas, and lots of alliterations are used over here. And the usage of sounds also evokes something in the listener. So those are, elements of alankar. This was given by Bhama, and it's about theory of figures. Figures are speech. And kavya. Kavya is poetry. Kavya is not just, is comes alive when both sound and the meaning blend together. So alankar, or poetic figure, is a very essential, important element of poetry. And we put up a striking idea in an equally striking word. So we don't just say regular mundane stuff and we try to give a very strong idea. The usage, all of our ancient Indian writers have been incredible in all of this. And I think Sanskrit is very magical. Even Tamil and a lot of our vernacular languages are amazing in that sense. So English falls short of words in this context. Like, I'm sorry to bring this up here. Why do we use alankar? We use alankar to underline an important part of a meaning of what the literal text is trying to say, to nourish the literal meaning to its climax, to give more beauty to the expression, to attribute some meaning, to also evoke splendor, and to express something which we are not able to in just random words. So here are some forms of alankar. Here are, why do we use alankars? This is very self-explanatory. When you'll read it, you'll understand, to increase beauty, enhance qualities, depict nature and all of that. So we can read that ourselves. Forms of alankar by Mamat are, rupak, see, look here in the English terms, the simile, metaphors, contradictions, virodh, deepak, these are all forms of alankars. And Bhama, Dandin, Udbhat, they also have talked a lot about this literary device. Now, Auchitya, ka original Hindi word, the original Hindi word is uchit. Yah uchit nahi hai. This is not appropriate. It's not fair. We often use this term. So, Auchitya means the theory of appropriateness. What is appropriate? This is important. This theory is proposed by Acharya Kshemendra. He was a student of Abhinav Gupta. So what he says is, the greatest gun or excellence of poetry is auchitya. Poetry should be appropriate. It should make sense. And its greatest flaw is the absence of auchitya, which is unauchitya. So there should be a communion. There should be a coherence between the theme and the form. And all of it should be very, very appropriate. These are some types of auchitya, and there are lots. I think even if we learn just 5 or 6 out of these, that would suffice. And these are all, like English grammar terms, just stated in Hindi or Sanskrit. So pad is phrase, vakya sentence, gun qualities, alankar figures of speech, ras bhava state, karak kriya ling, gender, verb, vachan number, visheshan, upsarg, pratyay, all of those things are over here. So please go through this and you might be able to understand. Shruti. So according to Indian metaphysics, there is a sound and that makes up the whole world. And now even NASA has recorded the sound of this of the sun, and it says, om, or it hums, or it talks like amen, or so all religion have had that particular sound in their culture, in some form of their prayer. And and that is what Shruti is. It's the silence between the sounds. What do you hear when you're not hearing anything? So it's got a relationship with speech act theory also by philosopher Jane Austen. And both of them state that language is used to perform acts, and language is a sort of action. And our Sanskrit texts have been transmitted through oral tradition, and they have been, you know, recorded via the oral medium, which is very, very incredible. Now, to conclude all of this, the Indian literature has been, like all other ancient forms of literature, has been oral, even Persian literature for that matter. They have all been oral in the beginning. And in this context of orality, literature was an act of public communication, you know, somebody speaking and all of them listening, whether that was a Gurukul or any of that kind of a setting. And see, even non-Hindu settings have been performative, have been oral, have been extempore. For instance, Mushaira. So when people come together and read Shero Shairi, Mehfil or Mushaira, that also has an oral tradition. And all of literature is either Shravya, Shravya, Shravan, Sunna, means listening through the ear, and Preksh, you know, something that we can watch. Or Shravya Preksh means both oral and visual. So any literature can be divided into that. Preksh is anything that I read. Shravya is something that I hear. And combine both of them together, audio-visual. And here, this is very beautiful. For the Western context, we use the terms for the audience. We say, you know, audience, participant, listener, viewer, reader, all of that. In the Indian context, you know, the listener or somebody who's absorbing that art form is, you know, someone who has the same kind of heart as the author, somebody who's able to empathize with the author, and he or she is a sahriday. Hriday means heart, and sahriday means one heart. So two people. So if the author has written a work of art or his thoughts about something, and the reader is reading it, the reader is a sahriday, and he tries to absorb that, tries to feel that literature, the reader might have tears in their eyes, he or she might be mesmerized or totally drenched into that beauty, and he might be able to understand or see what the composer or the poet has tried to convey. Of course, we can have subjective interpretations to that. And now we come to the last question here. Does too much of theory, you know, Indian aesthetics is so abstract, it's so beautiful, this work of art. And does breaking it down into theory spoil the glory or the beauty of this work of art? Actually, it does not, because in Indian context, literature is not just for analysis. Literature is for savoring, for tasting, for relishing. Which is why we are called Sahriday. All of you right now here are my Sahriday, and you are trying to take in the message that I'm trying to convey. I might be failing or miserably, but you are all rasik of this form of art. So this is how we, as receptors of any form of art in the Indian context, are rasik. So if you're in an auditorium listening to a music performer, you are a rasik, you know, when the performer sings a Shringar Ras Bandish and you really remember a beloved, you want to hold hands of somebody, of your own beloved sitting next to you, or you feel love for your child and things like that. So that is when the ras has been evoked within you. When you watch Tare Zameen Par, you had tears in your eyes. You really wanted to love all children around you, whether that they were your neighbors or... So these are what art can evoke in us. And the last, there's a comparison between ras and, I don't know how to call it, it's Jusa, or I think Kalyani ma'am can tell me better. But Roland Barthes was a French literary theorist, and he gave this idea of Jusa or bliss. And he said that reader is free from the oppression of authorial intention. What the author is trying to say, author cannot dominate the reader, and reader can have his or her own interpretation of freedom. And he has given a term known as death of the author. And reader can actually see the gaps, and he can explore things that can give him pleasure. And here they have drawn a similarity between both the theories of rasa theory and the jusa theory. Both insist on the effect that a literary text has on the reader. Both ras and jusa are reader-oriented theories, and both these metaphors have some undertones of sensual pleasure. Thank you so much for listening.